to talk about parenting from a child developmental level, because how you parent a 3-year-old is different from how you parent a 10-year-old, which is very different from how you parent a 17-year-old. You know, some of that is also just understanding that our children are going to change over time, and how do we adapt and change with them? You know, as adults, we don't stay the same. So it's really hard to expect our children to stay the same. So some of that is just learning from a child developmental perspective, what are realistic expectations for our children. You know, for example, my daughter's 6, I can't expect her to walk to the bus stop by herself. I'm just not gonna have that expectation. I need to be monitoring to make sure she gets there, make sure she's safe. Now when she's 17, she's gonna be like, Mom, go get dressed. I don't need you to walk me to the bus stop. You know, so it's learning what's appropriate and what's inappropriate. And I think it's also from a parenting perspective, understanding if you don't know something. And often we as adults are so caught up in our own ego that we think we know everything, even if we don't, so we don't want to accept help. So some of it may just be looking for that resource, but there are resources in our community to help people, but sometimes you have to figure out what you don't know. I don't know if that answered your question, but I know there are programs in our community.
Years ago, I was a kindergarten teacher in Rockford most of my career. And Joyce Holmberg, that was a senator down in Springfield for a while. Before she did that, she worked in the school district and worked with early childhood. And they had, I don't know if they were teachers, certified teachers or social workers, but they would go, like the kids that were in preschool, they would go to the homes and help the moms learn what they could do with their kids, about how to read with them and play games with them and help them figure out what to do. And that was just at a preschool level, but I never was aware of anything that was teaching parents of older students.
Right. And like I said, there are some classes here in the community that are few and far between, but again, I think a lot of that is because we don't expect to need someone to tell us how to parent, when the reality is we need all the help we can get. That's, you know, why you try to have community. You know, if I have friends that are I have a group of friends and we're all moms and we talk to each other, I'm having this issue with my child, how would you handle it? What are you doing? And then just to encourage each other as well as, this is not going to last forever, you know? Because when your kid's in diapers, you think your kid's gonna be in diapers forever, right? Potty training is terrible. But then, you know, it's always good to have someone around you that says, they're not going to be in diapers when they're in college, because then you know that, you know, there is a light at the end of the tunnel.
I guess the only comment I had was the extreme is a home that is actually not law abiding. And so the example that I think about is the parents in, I think it's the state of Michigan, who's son brought a gun to school, and then they're being held responsible for that behavior, and so I think that's the extreme. I wouldn't want that to be the norm, but I think it does indicate that there's a need for parents, as you say, to be a little bit more humble and say, we need help. And so the attitude that could be conveyed is that parenting is hard work, and there's just a tremendous need for mentoring and for examples of good parenting skills. Thank you.
So I have a question for Andrea. How many, would you say, it's a ballpark, you don't have to give me the exact number, of women do you supervise now?
Let's see, so officially and unofficially, I mean, I have folks that come to me looking to be mentored, mm-hmm. They seek me out, others are more formalized mentoring where their supervisor has sought me out, and then there's actually my direct staff. Mm-hmm. So. You know, I'd say that group altogether is about 20 mm-hmm. now, which is sometimes they're part-time students. We call them engineering co-ops or interns, where they come from a semester from school. They're with us for anywhere from 6 to 8 months, and then they go back to school. Others are full-time. Some are seasoned employees that are women, and some are just new grads coming out. And so it helps keep me young to actually work with all types of people. But I particularly enjoy mentoring women. And I'll go one step further to say that the STEM activities, science, technology, engineering, math, and now art, STEAM is now being tossed in there. I really enjoy working with middle school-aged young ladies because that's the time where all the distractions start. And it's not cool to be smart anymore and these kinds of things. And so I really enjoy that aspect, which is really outside of work. So, so thank you. Great question.
Yes. When I was living in Little Rock, Arkansas, the Science Museum there, they actually have a Girls in STEM program, where they have like spring programs and summer programs where you have engineers and different STEM related fields working with the girls. So it was a great initiative to be a part of. Wonderful.
What I noticed listening to all of you was that each of you saw mentorship or people that encouraged you or believed in you, whether it was your family or Gary or the head of the office that you're in, and each of these people that made you believe that you could do it. And I think we all need that. And everyone needs hope. And if we don't have that, we give up. So.
Anyone else have any questions? Do you have any questions for each other?
No, we were great.
You said your third tenet was preparedness.
Being prepared.
Prepared.
Yes.
Can you give us an example of how that was successful for you?
Well, just always being prepared for court. I think that helped me to get a job in private practice. That helped me to then apply for being a judge. You know, and it's funny because you don't always know how people view you until they tell you. You know, I'm just doing what I do, just being me, but just making sure that I knew what was going on all of my cases. I did that as a public defender. That's how I got the job in private practice. Just making sure I saw my clients, making sure I knew what they were charged with, understanding the possible consequences, understanding the law related to it. If that means you have to work nights or work on the weekend to get yourself ready, that's what I wanted to do because, you know, you want to present your best self. Not only for your client, but also in front of this judge who's going to be making these decisions about your client, potentially life-altering decisions. So I wanted to put my best foot forward. So being prepared is very, even now I prepare dockets. I don't just work when I'm on the bench. I have to, you know, get ready for court and know what's going on the cases and be ready to tell the attorneys what my expectations are. And some of that is really just knowing what's happening. So I think being prepared is very important.
I completely agree. You know, nobody wants to hear on the news that an aircraft did not land safely. And being prepared like that is not just your education and your experience, but it's kind of guessing what could go wrong and then making sure you fill that hole through either another analysis from my perspective or seeking out other opinions to help close it so that really bad day doesn't happen. And in your case, it's the same thing. So thank you.
And you know, even teaching kindergarten, you have to be prepared. I'd be at school till 6 o'clock on Friday night, making sure everything was ready for the next week. You know, it's just, if you're good at your job, you do that. And all of you, I know you do that. You have to be prepared.
I have a question for the panel, and whoever would like to answer it, or if you'd like to answer it in order. adjacent to that discussion about being prepared, do you feel as women in your professions you're held to a higher standard or have a higher expectation than perhaps male counterparts?
I'll go first. No, actually, I don't feel that. In the mortgage industry, you know, there is certain criteria that has to be met by the borrower, and whether you are a female loan officer or a male loan officer, you have to know what that is. And with experience, when there are issues, whether you're female, you learn how to resolve those issues. So even though we have, in our local branch, we have more female loan officers than male loan officers, we're a great family and we collaborate together. So it's just a matter of getting that problem resolved.
I agree. For me, it comes down to very stringent requirements in my field that we have to meet. And whether the idea comes from anybody on the team, it's a different world today. I'm happy to say it's a very different world. And everybody is afforded the time and the consideration for their own ideas. And that's what makes the better solution, so that diversity.
I actually have the opposite experience. I do think that sometimes women, especially in the legal field, are held to a different standard. Although I think about 55% women now in ABA accredited law schools, but I still think that law is a primarily male dominated profession just because, you know, we can be a lawyer for such a long period of time. So I do think the standards are different, and I think that as women we have to be, you know, there's still concerns about what you wear or what you're doing, and because law can be very conservative. So I do think women can be held to a different standard, and I do think you have to be aware of your circuit or your surroundings when you are presenting yourself, because the culture may impact how you are perceived and how far you can go in that area where you practice.
Yeah, I guess I would echo some of that in our field. Sometimes it's knowing the context especially, but I do feel like there's been instances, especially when I was an intern, of I knew the intern who I filled their spot, and then I knew the intern who came after me, who were two nice guys, but I will say, like, not prepared. There was a lot of, you know, fly by the seat of your pants type of stuff going on, and they use their charisma. And so kind of negotiating that context, it's like, okay, these guys are working off of charisma. I've been working off of preparedness. And in some cases, it's actually kind of loosened me up in some ways, where it's like, you know, you don't have to have every answer to be able to go and move forward. So in some cases, I've kind of picked up on that context, and I've kind of moved, not that I'm not prepared now, but, you know, kind of just going in and saying, all right, let's just figure out what the situation is, rather than going in with my three scenarios of what might happen. You know, I've kind of adjusted in that way. But in some cases in my role, I have to be the fact person, going through all the numbers. Here's how they crunch out. You know, this is how it's gonna play. And then in the other case, it's also trying to make a project happen and convince people that we have the right team to pull this off. So there comes the charisma again. So I think there's like that kind of flow between of knowing which skill set to tap into and when. But I think there's been cases where there's been an expectation that, well, I'll be the charisma person, you be the fact person, so you have to be ready. And I think there has been a little bit of that in my career, at least especially early in the grad school days.
And sometimes people don't expect you to be in your role. Mm-hmm. You know, I when I first started working at Durango and Kane, I was in the elevator with another woman, and I was like, well, I'm going to Trinity and Kane, that's where I'm working. She said, oh, so whose assistant are you? Mm-hmm. Because they don't expect you to be in the position that you're in. So sometimes it's breaking down, you know, well, and trying to figure out how to say it in a nice way, because if you don't respond a certain way, people will then look negatively on you. It's like, well, you know, I'm not an assistant, I'm one of the lawyers, but, you know, I really like working there, you know, and try to sandwich that in there in a polite way. So sometimes it's managing the expectations of others who don't believe you can be in the position that you're in.
Thank you all for that. Ashley, I have a follow for you just because I know your firm so well. And in the transition you're going to with Gary, the founder and long time, have you had experiences now that Gary's sort of transitioning where clients are like, okay, well, where's Gary? Because I know he's traveling more and not there every day. And
yeah, Not as much, I think, because over the last 8 years of working there, it's just been, you know, you get more and more FaceTime with clients, and there'll be cases maybe where they ask what he's up to, but not in the way that it's like, well, why isn't he a part of this meeting, or why isn't he leading this? But I think that's taken, you know, years and years of building those client relationships, that it's been kind of a transition for them as well to know that there's a shift in ownership and leadership, and it's gone pretty smoothly, I would say.
Great.
So I have another question. So most of you touched on the fact that you are mothers, but you also talked about, you know, working after hours. So how do you juggle that work-life balance with motherhood? Because, I mean, Andrea, you even said there's a lot of events that you prioritize to not miss, especially as your kids are younger. But to me, your daughter's still young. So how do you balance being a mom, helping put them to bed, being there at night, reading a bedtime story, or just spending time with your husband or your partner? How do you balance that? Because it seems like, I mean, you all are very established in your careers, but it's a lot of work, right? It doesn't end at 5 like a lot of people think. So how do you juggle that?
So personally, I have a very supportive home structure. My husband, he cooks. I'm not the cook, you know, and we have very, I'm the repair person, the DIY. So we have non-traditional roles in our home, and so we were able to, you know, when we decided to begin our family, we talked about all of that. And, you know, together we'd attend the soccer game, and one of us would have to go back to work, and the other one would be there for the family. So, you know, and that just rotated as needed. And so together we were stronger to build a stronger family that hopefully set new expectations for my children as they're now adults working in their respective fields, and hopefully we'll have their families starting sometime soon. So it was all about balance for me, but I had the support at home to do that.
I also have the support at home. My kids are all grown. I'm a grandmother of a lot. But my husband is a retired state parole agent, and the days that I have events, because surprisingly, it's crazy how much the mortgage real estate industry has events. I mean, there are weeks where I have 3 to 4 nights where I'm out attending this event or that event. I'm also on some boards. So, you know, and that takes time. So it is not a 9-to-5 job. But my husband is very supportive. He does know how to cook, although I am the better cook, by far. but I have been lucky to have that, you know, the family support system.
Yeah, I think having a supported home is helpful, and support of your village, whoever that might be. But when you asked about balance, in my mind, I'm thinking, balance? What is balance? Yeah. I don't know what that is. I'm just trying to make it every day. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, you just have to figure it out. I mean, in some days, it's going to be linear. This is the plan. And other days, it's going to be, we just, you know, we're flying by the seat of our pants. But some of just trying to plan whenever you can, and you know, I get the daughter to bed, you stay up, you work out, you do work, you just do it, mm-hmm. you know, and hope that everything will come together at the end, and usually it does, and whatever doesn't happen, it will be there tomorrow. And you have to remember, it's not the end of the world if everything doesn't get done in that 24-hour span, you know, because Lord willing, you'll be giving another 24 hours to work on the remainder.
And I don't have kids. It's just my husband and I, but he also has a very demanding job. He's an attorney, so you know, the time at night, time just flies away. I don't know where it goes. I feel like we struggle even to balance amongst ourselves. So it's really amazing to hear, you know, adding in kids to the mix, you know, and aging parents, you know, caring for parents and family members amongst that. And it's just a part of what you need to do, and it's really important. And if you don't prioritize it, then, you know, I think it's probably easy to just, you know, get your balance off.
I will say that probably my first role model was my mom, because she always worked out of the house. So to be able to see her juggle my sisters and I, you know, and make sure dinner was on the table and get all that, that was, I didn't think I was paying attention, but obviously I was. So.
And I echo that. That was the same experience I had. My mom always worked outside of the home, and watching her try to manage and help other elderly relatives and everything else and maintain our household. So it was just like, okay, this is what you do. So this is what we do. We just manage, and you just have to work on it. So I completely understand that.
Yeah. Well, would you say then that the expectation for having a work-life balance is more on women than on men?
Oh, absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Oh, yes.
Because they have wives. I mean, I want a wife. Literally. Yeah. I need another wife. I would love to have a wife. Okay? You know, I'm just... Because, you know, working with other male lawyers, one I'm particularly thinking of, if he ever watches this, he'll know I'm talking about him. But his wife stays at home, and I'm like, yeah, you have a wife. Like, you don't have to worry about all this stuff. I get home, I clock out at work, and I go home and clock in. Because then I have to cook the dinner. I have to, you know, and I'm not saying I don't have help, but you still have to wash the clothes and do the hair and the baths and all of those things that moms are usually, quote-unquote, expected to do. So it's not, you know... They have wives.
Yeah.
We are the wives, typically. So I do think men have different expectations. They're expected to go and slay the dragon and come home and relax. We're expected to go slay the dragon and come home. Well, slay the dragon's about, you know, you kill the cow, right? They kill the cow, they bring the cow home and we cook it. Well, I have to go kill the cow, come home and cook it and make sure everything's cleaned up after.
Yeah. Okay?
So I'll respectfully take the other side.
I like that.
So, having married an engineer, we're all about like program management at home, right? Yes. It's schedule, budget, you know, on time delivery. The day job is the home, and so pretty structured but flexible, you know, because stuff happens, right? Life happens, it gets in the way. But yeah, respectfully, I'll go the other route. But you know, there's havoc when you put two engineers as well, so peace.
Don't you think, though, too, you chose your job, you love what you do, and then you had family, or your children were there before you started the job, but you make it work because you want to be working. I remember we moved to Alabama for a year for my husband's job and came back, and I couldn't get a job teaching. I cost too much. I had 15 years experience and a master's degree, and Rockford would not hire me. And I got to spring break with kids. I did volunteer work for a while, and the kids were home spring break. I cried for a week. I was depressed because I didn't feel like I had a purpose. It's really strange, but I wanted to be working and feeling like I was contributing, even though I had a lot to do with the two kids and home and everything. So we make it work. You know, but you're right. The men have the wife to do that.
I like what you said because you thought you didn't have a purpose. And
yes,
that's right. In what I do, I have a purpose. That is a great motivator.
Yeah,
to make it work.
But that's the only time I ever felt depressed ever in my life.
But that's what makes you good at what you do, because you love it and you want to just
do
whatever.
And that's contagious. People can tell.
Yeah.
And that's really powerful.
Yeah. Wonderful. Well, thank you, ladies, so much for attending. I'm sorry it didn't turn out exactly how we hoped, but we enjoyed your presentations and hearing from you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And if you know, you or anyone you know,